All right, so what the fuck is Shmoo? Howdy, we're here, and there's a good bit of us up here, and what are we doing? Basically, we're trying to throw all of our current projects together with regards to wireless into one presentation, simply because we need more time to drink and do CTF. So it's more for our benefit than yours, but you get kind of the side benefit thing going on, too. Bruce can't be here. He's sick right now. So
too much alcohol.
Man. All right, so we will talk about last night, but there was a cockroach slash beetle, the one-legged guy that ate it the other year for $260, I think it was. Are you still in here? Because we're going to throw the pot up again this year and see if you'll do it. We have a lot of stuff to cover, not much time. Any of the projects that you see, if you need links to them, simply go to shmoo.com. We'll probably have links to the projects there for you. Let's get rolling. First of all, I'd like to introduce Pablos. Pablos is going to be talking about the HackerBot as well as some new things for this year's HackerBot. Basically, a guest appearance by the HackerBot. Applause, thank you.
Hey, so a year or so ago, Eric and I were hanging out in the Shmoo underground lair, gluing sharks to the backs of our lasers. Shark glue doesn't work, by the way. So what we were, actually doing was like stalking these teenage kids, high schoolers, who had robots, and we didn't. So it occurred to us that if they could build robots, we could build robots with infinitely more money than high school kids. So I went on eBay and bought the coolest wheels.
That basically means we can fuck up more times.
And we got cool wheels, and then we started building. Eventually, it occurred to us that we didn't need a robot to build our... Can you not hear me?
Yeah!
Okay, everybody. So, then what happened is we decided if we're going to build a robot, we don't need one to clean our room. So what we need is a hacker robot. And that's what we're going to need. So we started down the path of building the world's first hacker robot. So what you see here is made almost entirely out of parts we scored off of eBay and Craigslist and whatnot. And old DOD decommissioned shit and things. And what we did is stuck it all together so that all the hard problems would be software problems, which we knew were problems we could handle. And now what we have here is a bot that can drive around, find Wi-Fi users, and like laptop users, drive up to them and show them their passwords on the screen. If you have questions about the bot, it drives around. I can pull it over Wi-Fi from a laptop in my pocket, and everything's tunneled over it. Say, if you can root our bot this weekend, then like our deal. But it'll be done fine. And we'll drive around some and ask this question about it. The whole point of this is to say that, just because we have a machine shop and an underground lair, doesn't mean you can't build robots. Anybody can do this. You can buy all the parts off eBay. It's basically a PC, and we think it's a pretty cool platform for playing with.
Paul brings up a really good point. A lot of the things that you'll see up here, at least that we've been piecing together, we're really doing it more so to get you guys challenged as far as doing it on your own. We'd like to see more of this kind of stuff, particularly hang out with more people that are doing this kind of stuff. So make sure that you keep all of that in mind as we're going through all of this crazy, silly stuff. So now we're going to talk a little bit about the Hotspot Defense Kit. Why the Hotspot Defense Kit? Last year we talked about AirSnarf and stealing people's T-Mobile usernames and passwords at Starbucks. Walk in with a PDA, hit a button, order your coffee, walk out with 5 usernames and passwords or so. And the big thing there was that we realized that clients, as they're entering a hotspot environment or even in their corporate environments, don't have any type of awareness with regards to what's going on against them. So you've got major admins in large corporations that are deploying wireless intrusion detection systems that are spending tens, if not hundreds of thousands of dollars, basically to cover their entire AP zones. And they're not actually protecting the clients. The clients just kind of sit out there and get, reamed. And once in a while, somebody actually says, oh, we have a rogue access point that's out there, either somebody that's plugged it in on the corporate LAN or somebody that's actually decided to drive up and run a rogue AP. and the users have no awareness of what's going on. So basically, Hotspot DK is kind of like Zone Alarm for Wi-Fi. And Bob here has made a few different updates, or will be making some new ties to a new version of it, and is going to talk a little bit more about the internals.
Right, so what does Hotspot DK do for you? It looks for common attacks that you see all the time, especially on networks like here at DEF CON, which was kind of one of the inspirations for it. It looks for ESSIDs changing when you're set to any mode. All of a sudden, you get switched over. It looks for MAC addresses of your AP changing when someone's trying to masquerade for as an AP you were already associated to. It looks for your routes changing. It looks for signal strengths varying dramatically. All these things indicate that someone's trying to pull a fast one on your computer, redirecting your traffic through some other gateway to steal what you were doing. At first, we only did this for OS X, and this is what it looked like. It gave you a view of what the AP MAC, the AP's current MAC was, and let you trust it so that it always knew what was the current one, and it would light up like a Christmas tree if things started to go wrong. All sorts of different errors pop up, and it shows in the sys-tray what the current status of the network is, just to protect your client. Now, we've introduced one for Linux, and this will be out shortly on the website for you to download. It does the same things, and coming next is a Windows version as well, which will be released at TorCon, and that'll be in Beetle's presentation, correct?
Correct.
AirSnarf was where all this started, so if you want to find out more about this particular tool or the AirSnarf tool, visit airsnarf.shmoo.com.
So we started realizing that we were building a lot of different projects, and we kind of wanted our own little platform to play with and keep the projects cohesive and be able to like use them and demonstrate them without having to hack something together every goddamn time that we went up in front of somebody. So Holt is going to talk about wireless weaponry 1.0.
So as Neil said, we need a TV for, you know, breaking stuff on our plans at work and at home for demos and keep cool clothes. And, it's based on Morphix, which is based on Nopix, which is based on Debian GNU Linux. And we currently have it booting with a variety of network development wireless security tools. We have a little bit more work, and then we'll be able to release it. Currently, the holdup is a little bit of kernel funkiness with wireless drivers. It's best to use the Prism 2-based card with this. We use the Symeo and Genius 2511 200 milliwatt cards. There's significant amount of customization that you have to do to get this going. Morphix has made it easy up to a point, but once you start digging into the guts of it, there's things that are undocumented that you have to work through. They have a beast called the Total Mastering of Morphix that allows you to change main modules and mini modules. The main modules have like the base OS, the Windows install, and sometimes you have some other apps like OpenOffice and things. Mini modules are usually focused on a specific set of tools, like development tools, Wi-Fi tools, or whatnot. We hope to have first release that's like a beta release around TierCon. Check www.shmoo.com for more infos.
At least some of the boot screens for it and the desktop. You'll notice the desktop is replete with the crop circle Yagi antenna pattern. And naturally, the Shmoo logo, we like to look at ourselves every once in a while. And the Yagi antenna, the nice little comical sniper Yagi antenna that's there, that's pretty cute, huh? First of all, or actually in the middle of it all, Lenz decided that he wants to tell you a little story about this cute chick that he met just recently, and we feel that it's appropriate to bring it up here at DEF CON. Thank you.
So I was hanging out in the slots at Caesars after Black Hat, and
This chick sits down next to me and starts folding the machinery and asks about Black Hat and says that she's got some interesting things that she might want to talk about at a new Black Hat, and maybe she could take an hour of your time to have a talk about that. And she's actually here with us. So her name is Oracle, by the way. So I asked her to talk to Beetle and see what he thought of her possible presentation. So
I asked her, I said, you know, did the measles scare you? She said, yes, the measles scared me. And we asked her, what's the deal? She says, I've been sitting on a 2-year vulnerability that I can't really tell anybody about. And somebody's put a patch at least over my private parts, and hopefully that'll take care of it. We won't mention what's this in reference to, but you'll know soon enough, I'm sure.
We talked her out of spending an hour at Black Hat telling you she couldn't tell you what she was going to talk about, so.
You guys are
a team. There's obviously an industry out there that's willing to sell you the next greatest security feature for your wireless network. If you haven't heard about it yet, there's this thing called WPA, and everybody's telling you that as long as you enable WPA, there's all sorts of good things that will now happen on your wireless network as opposed to bad things. Well, we'll tell you something different.
All right, so I might as well go ahead and start talking about what WPA is. Well, we all know that 802.11 is weak. You know, AirSnort was written by a Shmoo. A large number of attacks written in 802.11, you've all heard that 1,000 times at every single DEF CON I've been to for the last 4 years, somebody has talked about 802.11b security, and we're not going to go over that. Well, so the IETF decided they want to try and fix it. So they started a working group, you know, yet a committee, and implemented a standard 802.11i, which is not yet ratified. Well, the Wi-Fi Alliance decided that 802.11b and 802.11g suck as it stands right now for security, so they wanted to take some of the features out of 802.11i and implement what they call WPA, otherwise known as Wi-Fi Protected Access. This is a subset of the IETF security enhancements for 802.11i, and it works. It's forced to the Wi-Fi Alliance wanted to make something that would work with already existing hardware. So your 802.11g hardware that you already have now, you can implement WPA over top of it. If you want to sell 802.11g stuff now and have interoperability certification from the Wi-Fi Alliance, so if you're Netgear, you have to implement WPA in order to get that. The Wi-Fi Alliance knew from the beginning that this was going to be a stopgap measure before 802.11i came out, yet, and they keep pimping it as being secure, but as we're going to show, it's really not. All right, what you just skipped was a slide talking about 802.11 security, and I'm not really going to cover it.
That's boring.
It's covered every single year at DEF CON, and we're going to skip that. So go to the next slide. All right, so is WPA any better? Well, what some of the things that WPA do is it replaces WEP with what's called TKIP, Temporal Key Integrity Protocol. TKIP uses RC4, but does a per packet RC4 key exchange instead of a per session key exchange. It adds a little bit of replay protection. There's a replay counter. If any of the packets have a replay, if the counter is reused, then it drops the packet and you know, logs something, hopefully, if your drivers don't suck. And it also adds key packet authentication, which is called a MICOMIC, which we're going to talk about in a little bit. That can be either done via MD5 sums or SHA-1 hashes of the header, depending on what key info type and what version of WPA you're running. Right. So a little bit more of the WPA features. One useful thing that WPA implements is external auth built into wireless. The WPA clients that exist for Linux can auth against Radius and LDAP and a bunch of other external authentication systems. This is known as WPA Enterprise. For those of you running WPA at home on your Linksys wireless access point, you're going to be running EAP, which does pre-shared keys just like 802.11b. This is known as WPA Personal. Both still create a master session key for the AP in the client, and it has a new key handshake. It's a four-way handshake that's used to verify the AP and the client know the session master key. And it's identical between the personal and the enterprise authentication. It's just different mechanism of generating the password that's used to generate the key. So that's useful for knowing when we actually want to attack it later. All right, what they didn't add to WPA that's in 802.11i is more better encryption. Instead of using RC4, use AES in counter mode with, you know, CBC MAC instead of the TKIP. They were supposed to add IBSS security. They didn't. More better handling of the initial key exchange. They still have all the same problems in 802.11b for the initial key exchange. They just compound it because they do it a lot more often. And they're going to call this WPA2. This is already implemented by some vendors. I know Cisco's gear already supports WPA2 as well as macOS. The Linux drivers don't support it yet. And most of the vendors are already implementing WPA and WPA2. All right, so how does WPA work? So the first thing it does, client finds a BSS, just like 802.11b. It associates with the access point. In the WPA mode, the client proxies the authentication through the AP. Once you're authenticated, it generates a master session key. In the pre-shared key version, the pre-shared key is used to generate the master session key. Then it completes the WPA four-way handshake and the group key handshake, which is done the exact same way as the four-way handshake. It configures the keys for unicast and broadcast, then all systems go and can go ahead and browse your porn. Well, that's how WPA works. All right. So what's wrong with WPA? Well, it still uses RC4 with a small key space. So, yes, the keys are, it's a per-packet keying, so it's not a per-session keying, so the keys change a lot more often, but since it's RC4 with a small key space, the NSA still owns you. And they added this wonderful thing called micro-MIC protection that we're going to talk about, and it's a great big denial of service that basically anybody running WPA is fucked. All right, so... So what is micro-MIC protection? It helps to deal with a replay tax and the forced rekeying. And when you're under attack, basically what happens is you disassociate, wait a little bit, and then reassociate. This will, instead of, you know, one of the things that AirSnort implements is the forced disassociate, reassociate. So you get the rekeying happening over and over and over again, and you are able to get the initialization vector packets more often. Well, if you add a wait time, then the amount of time that it takes to store all the packets that AirSnort would need to crack the keys is a lot longer. Well, they do some wonderful, great things. So if what happens is if two MIC failures happen in 60 seconds, you disassociate and then wait 60 seconds and associate. The wonderfully cool thing is if a client is the one that generated the MIC failure to an access point, the access point will disconnect everyone and then wait 60 seconds before allowing them back on.
Damn, that's interesting. What would you ever do with that?
And the really cool part is the MIC header is just an MD5 sum of the header of the packet. So what do we implement? What is called the WPA party pooper. It attacks the micro-MIC protection. Anytime the MIC packet is seen going across a wire, we spew packets with invalid MICs. It's just an MD5 sum, change a single bit, and it causes a MIC failure. WPA is implemented inside of Ethernet headers, so it's all the better for us. It's actually rather trivial to implement. For example,
that sounds really complicated, Kaz. Could you tell me the mad leap foo that you did to actually inject that MIC failure?
Yeah. Well, okay. So it's in, like I said, it's in Ethernet. You associate and then you do the WPA authentication after you've associated. So all you need to do is associate to the access point, and then using print in Perl and pipe to DNet to build an Ethernet header and then pipe to DNet to send, you can...
So you're telling me that somebody actually worked on a protection mechanism for 3 years and you broke it with a print statement?
Yeah, it's like a three-line Perl script if you wanted to.
Right on.
All right, so... Well, if you can generate Ethernet packets with Visual Basic, all the better.
Woo!
All right, well, WPA is still usable. Micro-MIC is done in the client while it's also done in the access point, so if you're running host AP for your access points, then all the better. If you're using, like, a HackerBot system, that would be great. Well, so for those of you that are running an operating system where you have the source for your WPA clients, such as Linux, you can change the software. Linux is... there's only one WPA client, WPA supplicant, and the WPA client for Linux is actually pretty cool. It's written in libpcap and libdnet. So so it can actually be ported to any other operating system than Linux. All right, so what you can do to turn off MicroMic protection is it's a one-line change to the WPA supplicant. You add a break statement to wherever in the driver it receives a MicroMic failure from the driver. You just return and don't actually disassociate. And right now, the only drivers that are vulnerable in Linux are the host AP drivers. All of the other wireless drivers suck and don't actually implement WPA correctly. As in, the host AP is the only one that actually implements all of the spec. But of course, without going saying, all the other operating systems other than Linux that support MicroMic are DOSable. And for those of you that are using the Linux Ant driver loader, so if you buy any of the 802.11g hardware that's sold at Best Buy, you're not vulnerable to this attack. But if you run Cisco gear, then you're vulnerable or DOSable. And oh, this is a 375-day exploit.
Yeah, we didn't have a 0-day. We just had like a 2-year day thing.
That nobody had actually ever bothered to implement before.
All right, so Bruce would actually be up here giving his rant on Bluetooth, and one of the big things that basically just came on Black Hat and what we actually implemented at Black Hat was a Bluetooth tracking experiment. So we basically ran sensors in a lot of different rooms and tracked as people walked around with their PDAs or their actual cell phones and determined what actual speakers they were like, you know, visiting. So go ahead and scroll through a couple slides here. One more. One of the tools that we have is Braces, and it's basically a Perl script that's actually using the HCI utilities from bluez.sourceforge.net. You're scanning, you're pulling in information, and then we have a mothership that actually resides on the internet, and we send that information back to them, and then you have a web page that actually displays a schematic or layout of the actual location that you're at, and as people move from room to room, you can actually watch them basically just by watching their MAC address move from room to room. There's all sorts of different location triangulation methods, and if we had more time, we'd go into more technical detail about it. These slides will be provided on our website as well as to the DEF CON staff so that you can have them. But there's all sorts of different foo that you can use. We actually just ended up using proximity based on where the sensors were and distributing them across different rooms. Go ahead, a couple more slides. Bruce's mad PowerPoint foo. Simply one of the errors that we had was that, you know, a sensor was actually located close to a wall joining two rooms and another sensor was farther away. Because of the dB loss between two of the different nodes, it actually seemed like the item, or in this case somebody's phone, was in one room when it was actually just beyond the wall, because there's a certain amount of dB loss through a wall and of course a certain amount of dB loss just over the air. Next slide. And another error that we had in our experiment watching more Bluetooth devices was simply because of inquiry request time. Next slide. The data from the last 2 days, basically we compiled it all, and Bruce gave a presentation on the last day of Black Hat showing people as they were moving from room to room and what people were interested in, what talks. Next slide. One of the individuals that we had here had a Sony Ericsson T616. That was his MAC address. And at 10 a.m., he decided to go to Program Semantics, where intrusion or ID diff navigate and audit at 11:15. But for some reason, he was at advanced return to address discovery. He just basically got bored, I guess, in the next one. Defeating honeypots, he was pretty interested in. But then he was in attacking obfuscated code. But then he went from obfuscated code to honey nets back to obfuscated code. So unless he was using his personal teleportation spell or some other bullshit, we basically screwed up at that point. But generally, we had a pretty good list of what people were going to. And the key thing here was that from a marketing perspective, an individual such as Jeff Moss could sit up there and say, from a web page, what are people interested in and where are they going? And as more and more people are using Bluetooth-enabled devices, this is actually going to be the mechanism that you are tracked from place to place in terms of your interest. And the reason it was in the anonymity and privacy track was because that's the problem here, is that you are actually losing a little bit more of your privacy thanks to the actual cell phone that's in your pocket. Next slide. Eric is going to talk a little bit about 802.11 bounce.
Thank you. All right. So, how many folks out here have looked a little bit sketchy with big antennas pointed at various objects? Anybody? All right. Well, so the idea here is that, you know, here we are, we're doing penetration testing, we're doing various audits of wireless networks. You know, it just, you tend to stand out with a big 24 dB parabolic dish, you know, attached to your head. So one solution to that is to use some kind of remote tool that can allow for out-of-band management of this. So here's an example. This tissue box that we've been have had on stage all day actually contains a remote Wi-Fi unit with a 200 milliwatt Wi-Fi card. So right in here we have we basically have a Sharp Zoris with a 200 milliwatt card.
What the hell?
You're shitting me.
Why would you do something like that?
So with this device, we can effectively communicate to it over the serial port. We can log in. We can run Kismet. We can break web keys. FedEx will ship it. It's a convenient device for getting into an infrastructure that would be otherwise unavailable to us due to whatever reasons.
Is this the battery?
Yeah, that's the battery.
Right on.
So we have a lithium-ion cell. It'll last about 4 hours. Obviously, with larger antennas and larger batteries, you could get away with a longer
What's
session.
The wattage on the 900 megahertz?
Oh, it's just a little 1 watt radio.
Oh, okay.
So with that device, we can probably get a range up to, I don't know, far enough. So looks like we have a question real quick. Today it would be about, I don't know, $500. Tomorrow, $100. Yeah. But ultimately, you wouldn't have a new pair of shiny bracelets. So, anyway, thank you.
Can I put that in something besides a tissue box? Do you have other models?
Sure, it could be in a football, a FedEx package, a box of candy, flowers.
Doll.
I don't know about the blow-up doll. I found they don't really get acceptance.
All right, so before we actually get to the Sniper Yagi, Len's going to actually be talking just a little bit away from here. So if you want to see another Shmoo and probably some other crazy things, make sure that you get to Len's talk, which is right after this in the tent. But let us announce an item that will not harm you unless we aim it at certain parts. And is not a weapon and certainly should not be construed as something that fires bullets. However, Mike is going to display this thing, and it's truly a work of art.
In other words, don't shoot us when we pull it out.
Now that's the shit! Alrighty. Basically, what we have here, and what really needs to go along with this, is the Shmoo Fashion Show presentation. I wrote down some notes here. I can't really see if I have them here. Let's see. Here we go. Cowboy M is sporting the latest of Shmoo offerings, the Sniper Yagi. While his shirt is Old Navy and his jeans are Levi's, nothing compares to the attention he receives when he dons this glorious bit of Wi-Fi weaponry. The business end of Cowboy's Sniper Yagi is a 14.6 dBi Yagi antenna from Antennix. While the stock is a custom one-off combination of welding, Bondo, and modified hunting equipment. Note the hacker black finish that screams, "Do you broadcast your SSID, punk?" Well, do you? Cowboy M likes to do his wireless work from a distance, and his stock-mounted dual Sony camcorder battery-powered 500 milliwatt 2.4 gigahertz amp provides all the input juice he needs to peg those pesky long-range APs. With a total power of 41 dB milliwatts, Cowboy M is probably breaking all sorts of FCC regulations right now. With an EIRP of 13 watts, conservative. But with great range comes great difficulty in identifying targets. Not to worry, Cowboy has his eyes on the AP prize with his high-powered rifle scope. With the addition of a lightweight and portable tripod, stability is never an issue. You're sure not to miss with this just-in-time-for-summer Wi-Fi fashion item.
Thank you, Cowboy M.
Yeah, Beetle, you might give him a few usage tips here.
Yes. First of all, do not take this thing out in public.
Do not brandish this in public on the street. You'll probably get shot.
We didn't bring it anywhere near an airport. We had to ship it here because, well, TSA, well, yeah.
Not even the same zip code as the airport. Serious.
Another thing is that Yagi antennas have back lobes, so when you turn this bad boy on, 13 watts, although the majority of it's out that way, you want to make sure that you're not behind it. The resonant frequency of water, 2.4 gigahertz, and your eyeballs are full of that. So we all know what happens to little pieces of meat when you put them in the microwave. That's the same thing that happens to your eyes when you get behind this and turn it on. So you actually need to be at a distance when you power something like this on. Make sure that you practice safe Wi-Fi experimentations.
Yeah, and one last thing here. You know, we literally just made this out of junk metal and some parts from Radio Shack. This is not anything that's that you can't make yourself. So like Beetle was saying earlier, this is just something to show you, to help challenge you to make things like this and get your creative juices flowing.
Build cool shit.
Yeah, man, build cool shit. That's really what it's about. We want to see more people doing this kind of thing, we are very interested specifically in providing a venue for such. So, ShmooCon will be in Washington, D.C. in early 2005. Right now it's going to be February. There will be three tracks, Break It, Build It, and Boff It. Break It is basically, breaking things. And Build It will be building things. The Boff It track is a little bit of a twist on other cons in that we are actually having a dedicated track to having people in a room arguing with each other. We're really into that. The CFP is out. The website is www.shmoocon.org. Links for building the Sniper Yagi, if you really need to get one of those, are on the shmoocon.org website. During CTF, you will see some propaganda for ShmooCon, and since we have just a little bit of time, we will at least run one of the ads for you. Right there. Big one, baby.
Really worth this thing.
I thought you said you were the Mac Man.
I was, but I sold it. Oh, you don't have QuickTime Pro. Whatever.
This one's one of my favorites, especially after Spot the Fed. ShmooCon is going to be a little bit different, and we really are excited about having folks out. We aren't going to be presenting at or on con. We're just really interested in having a lot of folks come out and have a good time, particularly with the Build It track. We're really interested in seeing what you guys have to offer. There's more propaganda. Like I said, visit CTF, and you'll see ads running ridiculous amounts of the time. One of the last things we at least want to say is that we do have at least a couple different presentations that will be at TourCon. So make sure that you're at TourCon. We really feel that that's a very nice conference that's in the Southern California area. So make sure you're at TourCon, and thanks very much. Have you guys...